Hey everyone, thanks for tuning into this video. Today we have Apar Gupta of the Internet Freedom Foundation talking to us about a topic which has all of us very confused at the moment.
Deepika's mall chat,
WhatsApp chats,
chats accessed by Republic TV,
WhatsApp par hui baatcheet ki details samne aayi.
It's about law enforcement, about WhatsApp chats, and it's about, you know, WhatsApp chats being read out in primetime television. So, without further ado, let's just get into the meat of it all. And so my first question to you, Apar, very honestly, because even I'm a bit scared in this particular scenario, is when can law enforcement actually seize my phone in the first place?
Actually, the range of powers, if you look at it under the Code of Criminal Procedure, are incredibly broad. And Explainer was authored by a practitioner, Mr. Amrit Grewal, who's an advocate who practices on criminal law. And I also ventured a conversation with Abhinav Sekri, who's also a criminal law practitioner, who's a contemporary of mine. And their view in terms of not only the law as it stands in the books, which is the black letter, but the actual operative process, is that the powers of police are immensely wide, right? They sometimes can seize devices even without conducting an official search. And if it's within the search, they can seize it and then they drop a seizure memo. If you refuse it, they can go and get a warrant from a magistrate. But quite usually what happens in these interactions is the police exercises a degree of coercion, force, and you're placed within an atmosphere of fear. So quite often people just give up their devices because either you fear the penalty will be tougher, so you better just cooperate and get it over with. Or you are thinking that, hey, I've not done anything wrong, so let's just give them a quick look into my smartphone and then I can go on my way. But as we've discovered, that devices which are turned over, even during the course of an investigation, the contents of them may often link to conversations which are 2 or 3 years in the past.
Yeah.
They can be excerpted contextually. They can be shown on primetime television. And IMA bounce can be actually represented or misrepresented to be an element of financial impropriety and embezzlement, which can conduct a large-scale media trial. So the question which is arising and the fear which is arising in a lot of people's minds is very, very well justified. Unfortunately, the law is not here to shield you.
Oh, okay. So in this particular case, do I have a right to refuse if I'm asked for my phone?
Yes, you do have a right to refuse, but what will happen practically, and we know this just even when you stay in a metropolitan elite kind of environment where we can negotiate very easily and the police knows just by talking to us, just by the way that we look, that we'll have access to social and economic segments where they can't really, really threaten us beyond a point. The thing is that they will exercise some degree of force. They will say that what you can do, what you cannot do. And if you do refuse, they can just go to a magistrate, get a warrant and get the P's and T's checked off. The power of the police to when it's investigating an offense is immense. The law, as it's conceptualized under the Code of Criminal Procedure, is essentially contemplating that the penalty which a person faces is not the investigation. It's not the trial when you go before the court. It's the conviction. So the Code of Criminal Procedure and the Evidence Act is actually post towards giving you safeguards, remedies and rights that you're not convicted improperly. It doesn't seem to limit the police in investigation because the colonial view has always been that it shouldn't matter how we get the evidence. If a person is guilty, we should have a higher degree of flexibility as a law enforcement agency to do it.
Yeah. Okay, no, that's really interesting. And especially because you said, you use the word warrant over here, right? And I'm really interested because usually when you have a warrant, you kind of have to show the extent to which you will search a property, such as the house, etc. I mean, our law enforcement, even if they take, you know, the step to get a warrant, do they have to kind of limit the purpose of their search or what they can search in your phone?
So the traditional argument has been that when a warrant has been issued, the police needs to be fairly specific in how it exercises those powers. So you'll notice this expression quite often in court judgments that the police can't go on a quote-unquote fishing expedition, which means cast a very wide net. That analogy basically brings up a graphic of a trawler just going through the sea and trying to gather everything and just sorting through that. So they need to have a degree of specificity when they actually seek to explore what's within your property. However, if you look at special enactments, even beyond the Code of Criminal Procedure, such as the Prevention of Money Laundering Act, these powers have been expanded over a period of time. So for instance, with respect to bank accounts, when there is a search order or a warrant issued, there's also the power of seizure, which is given with it.
Okay, so it's practically also
it might not be very broad. Let me just break it down. It's very, very broad. All these answers which you're getting will be disappointing, but will be accurate because I'm trying to also represent actually the practiced reality of criminal procedure and process as opposed to only the idealized form of theory which is taught in law school.
Yeah.
And here's the other part also. Here's the kicker. So a lot of people draw their inferences about what happens with the police based on what they view in terms of their media consumption through movies or through television shows. And quite often they happen to be things such as when I was growing up, for instance, Ally McBeal or Practice, and much more contemporary shows are like The Suits or Boston PD, things like that people watch. So the thing is, those things are not fitting very well with what's actually applicable in India. Yeah. For instance, under our Evidence Act, evidence which is gathered illegally, declared to be illegal, is still admissible in evidence as per the R.M. Malkani judgment. Yes. So even if a court holds that a police which did not have a warrant entered your property, seized your device after slapping you, and all of that is recorded, and then went into your device on the basis of brute force, either exercised on you as a physical person, okay, on your body to unlock it, or through a sense of threat which is exercised, gets the evidence in a completely illegal manner. Even then, that evidence which is gathered, if it goes to support the criminal investigation, which is then taken towards trial and says, for instance, you engaged in petty theft, still admissible within that course of trial. The law as it stands today under the Evidence Act in India is very clear. As per the R.M. Malkani judgment, it says that illegally gathered evidence is admissible in trial.